Hi, welcome to Coding Droplets. We are going to create a simple microservice solution which contains multiple microservices, and each microservices will use different databases like SQL Server, MySQL, MongoDB, etc. In this video, we'll create the first microservice, an ASP.NET Core Web API microservice which uses SQL Server database for saving the data. And in the upcoming videos, we'll create other microservices, and finally, we also create an API gateway which will route data to all these microservices. In this video, we'll also add Docker Orchestrator support for our project and configure the Docker Compose YAML file. So before starting, you should know a few things. This video is part of a series named Microservice Architecture. You can find the playlist link in the video description to watch the other videos in this series. So let's get started. I have opened Visual Studio, and let me click on Create a New Project button to create the new microservice solution. Here I am searching for a blank solution and selecting it, then clicking on Next. Let me provide a name for the solution. Let it be Demo Microservice Solution. Then clicking Create button to create the solution. Now in the Solution Explorer, you can see a blank solution. Next, I'm adding a new solution folder by right-clicking on the solution. Select Add, then choose New Solution Folder. We can name it as Microservices. Under that folder, I'm creating a new project. Just right-click on the folder, and inside Add option, I'm clicking on New Project. Now let me search for API, and you can see a project template named ASP.NET Core Web API. So I am selecting that and clicking on Next. Now let the project name be Customer Web API, then Next. Here I am using .NET 6 framework, and we can uncheck the configure for HTTPS checkbox. Also, I am unchecking enable Open API support, but you can check that if you need to enable Swagger. In this video, I'll be using Postman for testing the API methods. Let's click on Create to create the project. So now you can see the project in the Solution Explorer. Visual Studio will create Weather Forecast Controller and Weather Forecast CS files for demo purpose. We don't need those, so let me delete both the files. For SQL Server database, read and write operations, we need Entity Framework Core libraries to be installed. So let's open NuGet Package Manager and install the needed libraries. Let me navigate to Browse tab. First, we need to install microsoft.entityframworkcore.design. I'm installing it. Next, we need microsoft.entityframworkcore.sql server. Installing that as well. The last one is microsoft.entityframworkcore.tools. These three libraries are sufficient for us to do the SQL Server database operations. Next, we can create a model class for our entity. Let me create a folder named Models. Inside that folder, I'm creating a class named Customer. In Customer entity, we need four properties. First one is customer ID, which is the unique ID of the entity. Then customer name, mobile number, and email. For the entity class, we can use table attribute for mentioning the table name and schema in the database. Next, we can add the key attribute for customer ID to denote that it is the primary key. Also, we can add the attribute database generated of database generated option dot identity to denote that the column generates the value automatically upon insert. I am also providing column attribute to mention a custom column name. Let me provide the column attribute for other properties as well. I need the column names to be as mentioned in the database: customer underscore name, mobile underscore NO, and email. Next, we can add the dependency injection for SQL Server entity framework in program.cs class. Currently, I am hard coding db host, db name, and db password values. We'll be changing this while configuring the Docker Compose. Next, I'm declaring a variable named connection string, which will use the above variables to construct the connection string. Finally, adding the dependency injection by providing builder.services.addbcontext of customerdbcontext. Currently, we don't have customerdbcontext class. We'll be creating it now. So let me create a new database context class in the project. I am naming it as customerdbcontext. This class should be inherited from the dbcontext class, which is a part of entity framework. Now I am creating a constructor for this class and providing dbcontext options as the constructor parameter. It should also call the base class constructor to which we can pass dbcontext options as the parameter. Now inside the constructor, I am providing a try-catch method. If any error occurs, we'll write the error message in the console window. Next, I'm creating a database creator object, which I need to use for creating the database if it doesn't exist. So we are just checking whether the database creator object is not null. If it is not null, we are creating a database if the database creator object cannot connect to the database. Next, we are creating tables if the database is not having any tables in it. That's it needed in the constructor. Next, we are declaring dbSet for customer entity. Let's name it as customers. Now we can use this customerdbContext class in our dependency injection. Next, let's create an API controller in our project. I'm choosing an empty API controller template. I'm naming it as Customer Controller. First, let me create a constructor for this API controller class, and we can receive the customer DB context as a parameter as we have done the dependency injection. So I'm creating a private read-only customer DB context object and assigning the received object to it. Next, we can create a method for fetching the customer data. It is a HTTP GET method. In this method, we just need to return the customerdbContext.customers. So that will return all the customers. I'm creating one more HTTP GET method, which accepts the customer ID in the URL. This method should return details of the customer with that ID. So let's fetch the customer by filtering with the customer ID. We can use find async method for that. Now we can just return the fetched customer object. Next is a HTTP POST method for creating a new customer. This method accepts customer data as a parameter. We can send the customer as the request body while calling this method. I am saving the customer data using add async method of the database context. Also, we need to provide database context.save changes for saving it. Then, just I'm returning an OK response. Next is HTTP put method to update an existing customer record. This method also accepts the customer object as a parameter. We can just call the update method of the database context to update it. After that, saving changes as we did before. This method also returns an OK response. The final method is HTTP delete method to delete a customer. This method accepts customer ID in the URL. First, let's fetch the customer with the received ID. Then, I have provided the remove method of the database context to delete it from the database. Finally, saving the changes and returning an OK response. So now, our API controller is completed. Now let's test this API using Postman. Just before that, I'm opening SQL Management Studio. Here you can see I don't have any databases in this machine. Now let me run the application. So it is running now. You can see the application is listening on port number 5284. Let me copy the base URL. Now we can test the API methods using Postman. First, let me create a new collection in Postman and naming it as Demo Microservice Solution. Under that collection, I'm creating a new folder and naming it as Customer Web API. In that folder, we can add a request now. Let me paste the copied base URL, then providing the path of the customer API controller. In the project, you can see the route attribute in which the path is mentioned. The controller decorated with square brackets will get replaced with the controller name. So this is a HTTP GET method, and this should execute our GET customers method in the API controller. You can see that we have received a 200 OK response. That means the API execution is successful. There are no customers in our database, and that is why we cannot see any data. Now let me open the SQL Management Studio and just refresh the database folder. You can see now the database got created. Also, it created a table named customers in the database. The table is not having any records in it. So back to Postman, and I am saving this request so that we can use the same request to test later. Let me rename it to get customers. Now let's create another request and providing the same URL. This time we can choose HTTP POST method to create customers. For POST request, we should send the customer data as the request body. We can provide the data in JSON format. So first property is customer name, and let the customer name be John. Second property is mobile number. I'm providing a dummy mobile number. Third property is email, and let the value be john@email.com. Now let me click on the send button, and you can see we have received 200 OK response here. Let's check the customer data in SQL Management Studio as well. The data has been saved successfully in the database. Let me create one more customer by providing a different name, mobile number, and email. We have received a success response. Let me also check in the SQL Management Studio. We can see the record in the database. Let me save this request as well in Postman and naming it as create. Now creating another request for getByID. For getByID, we must use HTTP get method, but we must provide the customer ID along with the URL. I'm fetching the customer data with ID 1. Now it has listed only one customer record, which is having the provided customer ID. Let's change the ID to 2, and now you can see it has displayed the second customer data. Let me save this request as well in Postman with the name getByID. Now creating another request and changing the method type to put. The request is used for updating the record. We must provide the customer data to be updated as the request body, as we did in the post request. In the same way, we can provide the customer data in JSON format. Let me copy the JSON content from the post request, which we have created before. But this time, we also must provide the customer ID, so that it will update the customer record that matches the particular customer ID. So I'm updating the customer with ID 2. Let me make some changes in the name and email. Let the mobile number be the same. We got 200 OK response. Let's check in SQL Management Studio. Now you can see that instead of adding a new record, it has updated the record with the provided ID. So let me save the request and naming it as update. Now creating the final request to delete the record, the method should be delete. We must provide the customer ID along with the URL for deleting the record. Let's delete the record with ID 1. The request is successful. Let's check in SQL Management Studio, and you can see the record got deleted successfully. So saving this request as well with the name delete. Next, we are going to add container orchestrator support for this project. We also include SQL Server Database as a separate container. For adding container orchestrator support, just right click on the project, then go to add option and choose container orchestrator support. I'm using Docker Compose as the container orchestrator, then choosing Linux as the container operating system. Now Visual Studio created a new Docker file inside our project and a Docker Compose project in the solution. Visual Studio will start pulling the needed Docker images. Let it run in the background. We can just check the newly created Docker file. There are several instructions to create the Docker image of our project. You can see that there is a Docker instruction to expose port number 80. So our application will be listening for port 80 inside the container. Now let's open the Docker Compose YAML file. We are going to modify this file as per our need. We also need to include SQL Server service in the Docker Compose YAML file. First, let me create a network under Networks section. Let the network name be Backend. We'll assign this network for both the API and the database containers. So for the API, let me assign backend network by mentioning it in networks. Next, let's create a new service named CustomerDB. This is for SQL Server. First, I am providing a custom container name. Let it be customer-db. Then providing the image. In the last video, we have already seen about SQL Server image in Docker Hub. I'm using the same image. Next, we can provide the environment variables. Accept user and license and system admin password. I'm assigning the same backend network for this container as well. We can also provide a custom container name for the API container so that it will be easier to identify. Now I am assigning some environment variables which we are going to use for constructing the database connection string. First one is db_host. Here we can provide the database container CustomerDB. Then db name, let it be customer. Then db SA password for assigning the system admin password. We can copy the same password from the db environment variable. Now we can modify the connection string to read values from this environment variables. So to read values from environment variables, we can use environment.getEnvironmentVariable method. We must pass the variable name as a parameter. First, let me copy this and modify db name and db password. Now let's provide the environment variable names. db_host for db host, then db_name for db name, and db_sa_password for db password. Next, we need to map port numbers for these services. For the database, I'm assigning 8001 for 1433. 1433 is the default port number for SQL Server. For the API, I'm assigning 8002 for port 80. We have already seen in the Docker file that the container will expose port number 80. Fine, that's it. Let me build the Docker Compose project and confirm there are no errors. So the build got succeeded. Now we can try debugging the Docker Compose from Visual Studio itself. It is creating the needed containers. Some existing containers are removed and recreated. In the container window, we can see the assigned environment variables for both the containers. In the API container, we can see the DB host, DB name, and password. I'll show you the containers in Docker Desktop as well. You can see both containers with the assigned port numbers. Now let me connect SQL Management Studio to the SQL Server in the newly created container. The server name should contain port number as well, as we are not using the default port number. So I'm providing localhost colon 8001. Then the SA password, we can copy it from the Docker Compose file. And I got logged in. Now there are no databases here. So let's try to call an API from Postman. First, let's create a new customer. We need to change the port number to 8002 and let the customer data be the same. We got a 200 OK response. Let's check in the database now. Just refreshing it and you can see the database got created. Let's open the table and check now. You can see the customer record, so everything is working perfectly. Let me also execute the getCustomers request by changing the port number. It is returning the customer records. So now we have created our first simple microservice. We'll be creating another microservice with a different database in our upcoming video. And finally, we'll create an API gateway to communicate with all the microservices. So that's it for this video. Hope you liked it. Please subscribe, like, and share this video. See you all in the next video. Thank you.